Hello everyone, this is the history tutorial video for class 12. We were doing trade routes and coins and inscriptions in the previous video. We have been studying excerpts of inscriptions among other things, but how do historians find out what is written on them? Let's see. Most scripts used to write in modern Indian languages are derived from Brahmi. Brahmi was the script used in most of the Ashokan inscriptions. From the late 18th century, European scholars, aided by Indian pundits and linguists, they worked backwards from contemporary Bengali and the Hindi language, which is the Devanagari script is used for Hindi language, and the Bengali script is used for Bengali language. So they worked backwards using these two scripts, Bengali and Devanagari, comparing their letters with older specimen. Now scholars who studied early inscriptions, they sometimes assumed these were in Sanskrit, although the earliest inscriptions were in fact in the Prakrit language. It was only after decades of painstaking investigation by several epigraphists, those who read inscriptions and decipher inscriptions, those are called epigraphists. So, investigations by several epigraphists had been undertaken by the ASI, and then after all those, James Prinsep was able to decipher the Ashokan Brahmi script in 1838. So James Prinsep was the first man to decipher in what language the Ashokan script was written, or in what script was the Ashokan inscriptions written. That was the Brahmi script. Now we come to the Kharosthi script. The story of the decipherment of Kharosthi script, this Kharosthi script is used in inscriptions in the northwest. So the decipherment of this script is different from that of Brahmi. Here, finds of coins of the Indo-Greeks who ruled over the area have facilitated matters. How? These coins contain the names of kings written in Greek and Kharosthi scripts. European scholars who could read the former, who could read the Greek language, they compared the letters between the Greek script and the Kharosthi script. For example, the symbol A. Okay, A can be found in both the scripts for writing, such as Apollodotus or Androcottus. With James Prinsep identifying the language of the Kharosthi inscriptions as Prakrit, it became possible to read longer inscriptions as well. So basically, Ashokan inscriptions were written in Brahmi, and the Indo-Greek coins had Prakrit language with the Kharosthi script. To find out how epigraphists and historians work, if we see the two Ashokan inscriptions, if we compare two Ashokan inscriptions, we can see that the name Ashoka is never used. What is used instead are titles. What titles? Devanampiya. The R is silent in the Prakrit language. So, Devanampiya. Or in Sanskrit, it would be Devanampriya, which means the beloved of the gods, a person who the gods love, Devanampriya. And Piyadarshi. Piyadarshi in Sanskrit becomes Priyadarshi. Priyadarshi means good to look at, good to behold, pleasant to behold. The name Ashoka is mentioned in some other inscriptions, which also contains these titles. after examining all these inscriptions and finding that they match in terms of content, style, language and paleography, epigraphists have concluded that they were issued by the same ruler, that is Ashoka. Now, we can notice in these inscriptions that Ashoka claims that earlier rulers had no arrangement to receive reports. If we consider the political history of the subcontinent before Ashoka, can we think this statement as being true? Historians have constantly have to assess statements made in inscriptions because there are all kinds of statements. The historians have to judge whether they are true or whether they are plausible or just simple exaggerations. Historians have to make other assessments as well, like if a king's orders were inscribed on natural rocks near cities or important routes of communication, would passerbys have stopped to read these? Because most people were probably not literate. Did everybody understand the Prakrit language in the subcontinent? The Prakrit language, which was used in Pataliputra, which is the capital of the Mauryan Empire. Did everyone in the subcontinent understand the Prakrit language? It is not likely. Would the orders have of the king been followed? Because answers to these sort of questions are not always available. They are not easy to find. Some of these problems are evident if we look at an Ashokan inscription, which has often been interpreted as reflecting the anguish of the ruler, as well as marking a change in his attitude. This was probably right after the Kalinga battle, where Ashoka had a change of heart. Now, while Ashokan inscriptions have been found in present-day Orissa, this one, the one depicting his anguish, this one is missing. In other words, the inscription has not been found in the region that was conquered. What are we supposed to understand from this? Is it that the anguish of the recent conquest was too painful to bear from the region, and therefore the ruler was unable to address it? So he moves away from the place of anguish, and thereafter he expresses his feelings on a rock edict. These are possible explanations. These may have happened, these may not have happened. Further investigations are required. By now it is probably understood that there are limits to what epigraphy can reveal. Sometimes there are technical limitations. Letters are very faintly engraved. They have been, eroded over time, and thus reconstructions are uncertain. Also, inscriptions may be damaged or letters are missing. Besides, it is not always easy to be sure about the exact meaning of the words, the words that are used in inscriptions, some of which may be specific to a particular region. Regional word, probably regional dialect. If you go through an epigraphical journal, you will realize that scholars are constantly trying to debate and discuss alternative ways of reading inscriptions. Although several thousand of inscriptions have been discovered, not all have been deciphered. For example, the Indus Valley inscriptions, the Indus Valley seals, what is written on them, it has not yet been deciphered. Besides, many more inscriptions might have existed which has not yet probably discovered, or maybe they have been destroyed because of the time. So what is available at present is probably only a fraction of what was available back then. There is another, perhaps more fundamental problem, because not everything that we consider important politically or economically, it was not necessarily recorded in inscriptions. Because routine agricultural practices, or like joys and sorrows of daily people, they find no mention in the inscriptions. Inscriptions focus mainly on grand, unique events. Also, the content of inscriptions almost invariably projects the perception, the viewpoint of the person who commissioned them. So it always reflects the viewpoint, it always reflects the perspective of the king or the one, the powerful person who commissioned these inscriptions. As such, they need to be juxtaposed, they need to be compared with other perspectives so as to arrive at a better conclusion, a better understanding of our past. So that's it. We have completed this chapter, chapter 2 of your syllabus. I will give you question answers on this chapter in the next video. Till then, bye.